K. Francis Reynolds of Van Alstine passed away December 5th, 2020. She was a beloved wife, mother, granny, sister, aunt, friend. Her passions in life were her grandkids and gardening, in that order. She was a faithful follower of Christ, and her life was a reflection of that faith. Kay was born on August 9th, 1943, in Pueblo, Colorado, to Cecil and Francis Rowland. She is survived by her husband of 36 years, Doyle Reynolds, son James Miller, and wife Stephanie of Tulsa, Oklahoma, daughter Tony Taylor and husband Dan of Tombaugh, son Greg Reynolds and wife Philomena of Denison, son Brad Reynolds and wife April of Cleveland, Georgia, son Vance Reynolds and wife Paula of Florence, South Carolina, daughter Brandy Fair and husband Jesse of Tombaugh, brother Gene Rowland, wife Flora Lee of Argyle, brother Ronald Rowland and wife Charles C. of Princeton, sister Judy Morris and husband Ray of Bales, brother Jerry Rowland of Bales, sister Gail Carlisle of Bales. She was also blessed with 21 grandchildren, 14 great-grandchildren, and two more on the way. As I think of Kay, I think of her servant's heart more than anything else. Being away for a lot of my life, I'd come in twice a year, and the family was always gracious enough to try to get together when we would make it in, and have a little family get together, and Kay would always be in the kitchen 2 hours before, 2 hours after, making sure everyone was taken care of. That humble, gentle servant spirit should in no way be mistaken for weakness. She wasn't weak at all. In fact, if you ever messed with her grandchildren, you knew she wasn't weak at all. And if you ever made Kay upset, well, Doyle was right behind her. He'd have to deal with him. And being my dad, I can tell you he's probably the best dad in the world. But I can also tell you he's a tough old codger at times. But Kay knew how to handle him. They had a love that Hollywood can't even make up. It was an incredible love. But she sure loved those grandchildren too. So many times I'd watch those hands cup those grandchildren's faces and give them sugars, kisses just constantly. Wonderful memories for us and how she loved those precious grandchildren. As I get older, and I've done numerous funerals, but as I get older, I've, for the last 10 or 15 years, I've started saying what I think those who've passed on would want me to say. And I believe if Kay could come back right now, if somehow supernaturally God would just give her life just to spend one more moment with us, there would be two things she would say. I think the first thing she would say to all of us is, it's real. It's real. On this side of death, it's a religious philosophy, a biblical teaching, a hope. But when you cross over, it's real. Heaven's more real than you or I sitting here today. And I think she would say to us, it's more amazing, greater than anything you've ever heard or read about. It can't be compared. And the second thing I think she would say is, I want you all here. I want you all with me forever and ever and ever. You know, there's a few realities that none of us can escape. One of them is that we all make mistakes. It's what the Bible would call sin. We all do things that are wrong. And doesn't take a rocket scientist to know that. We all recognize that. The second is that there is a God. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to walk out in nature and realize there is a God. Perhaps the greatest hoax that's been played on secular education in the last 200 years is the hoax of secular humanistic evolution. You just look at nature. Look at the stars. There's so much evidence that there is God. And by definition, he would have to be love. If God were to reveal himself, he would say, I am love. Because that's what a supreme being is just love incarnate, if you will. And there's a problem there because of that. I'm a sinner, but God is love. There's no way I can make it to him. He would actually have to come to me. You know Kay's favorite time of year is Christmas. It's the time when God came to man, when God left heaven and came to earth to live a perfect life. Only God could do that. Only man could die for man's sin. Thus the God-man, Jesus Christ. And that's why the Bible would teach us that if we would believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord, we would be saved. You know, all of that makes sense, that we sin, that there's a perfect God, that because of my sin I can't go to heaven and make it not perfect, that God would have to come to earth and die so he would pay for my sins. An eternity in 6 hours, only an infinite God could do that on the cross, paying for man's sin. And if by faith I trusted him, I could go there. Kay would say, I want you all to be here. There's no mask in heaven. There's no hospitals. There's no pain. There's no sin. There's no sorrow. There's no death. Because there's no sin. It's all been taken care of. And I want to encourage you to think about that as you think about Kay. Think about what she would want and where she would want us all to be. I'm going to pray, and I'm going to pray for my dad and my family. And I'm going to ask, if you will, to join me in that prayer, just praying for them, thanking God for this amazing woman that you're going to hear more wonderful stories about in a moment. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you so much for Kay. And Lord, sometimes the English language fails to express what we feel in our heart. But God, you know. You know our thoughts and our love. And Lord, we just want to thank you for a life that was well lived before all of us. I pray for my dad as his soulmate's now in glory. I pray that you'll continue to be with him. And the whole family, Lord, be with us as we're going to miss Kay. Be with the children and the grandchildren. And comfort as only you can. You tell us in your word to comfort one another with your word because we have that hope. You tell us in your word that your word brings us comfort. And you tell us in your word that your Holy Spirit does. So we ask you to comfort as only you can. And then, Father, we ask that you be glorified and honored and that we rightly honor this wonderful life that was lived before us. In Jesus' name, amen.
I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above. If I count all the blessings the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of him beyond mortal ken. I'm sure that he'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, where all our troubles and heartaches have vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. Come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew. While I stroll over heaven with you, I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to dance in heaven with you some glad day, where all my troubles and heartaches have vanished away. Things are new. I want to dance in heaven with you. I want to dance in heaven with you. With you.
Precious memories, unseen angels sent from somewhere to my soul. How they linger ever near me, and the sacred past unfolds. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. Precious Father and loving Mother, fly across the lonely years, and old home scenes of my childhood in fond memory appear. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold.
I remember Mother praying, Father too, on bended knee. The sun is sinking, shadows falling, but their prayers still follow me. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. Precious memories fill my soul. Gladly
walk across the desert with no shoes upon my feet to share with you the last bite of bread I had to eat. I would swim out to save you in your sea of broken dreams. When all your hopes are sinking, let me show you what love means. Love can build a bridge between your heart and mine. Love can build a bridge. Don't you think it's time? Don't you think it's time? Whisper love so loudly every heart could understand. But love and only love can join the tribes of man. I would give my heart's desire so that you might see. The first step is to realize that it all begins with you and me.
Love can build a
bridge between your heart and mine. Love can build a bridge. Don't you think it's time? Don't you think it's time?
Yeah.
Don't you think it's time?
Imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
One day shy of 8 years old, when Grandma passed away, I was a broken-hearted little boy blowing out that birthday cake. How I cried when the sky let go with a cold and lonesome rain. Mama smiled, said, "Don't be sad, child. Grandma's watching you today. 'Cause there's holes in the floor of heaven, and her tears are pouring down. That's how you know she's watching, wishing she could be here now. And sometimes if you're lonely, just remember she can see. There's holes in the floor of heaven, and she's watching over you and me." Well, seasons come and seasons go, nothing stays the same. I grew up, fell in love, met a girl who took my name. Year by year, we made a life in this sleepy little town. I thought we'd grow old together. Lord, I sure do miss her now. But there's holes in the floor of heaven, and her tears are pouring down. That's how I know she's watching, wishing she could be here now. And sometimes when I'm lonely, I remember she can see. There's holes in the floor of heaven, and she's watching over. My little girl is 23. I walk her down the aisle. It's a shame her mom can't be here now to see her lovely smile. They throw the rice, I catch her eye as the rain starts coming down. She takes my hand, says, "Daddy, don't be sad, 'cause I know Mama's watching now. And there's holes in the floor of heaven, and her tears are pouring down. That's how you know she's watching, wishing she could be here now. Sometimes when you're lonely, just remember she can see. There's holes in the floor of heaven, and she's watching over you and me." She's watching over you and me. Watching over you and me. She's watching over you and me.
tissues out real quick. Hang on. Is this yours? Okay. For anybody that doesn't know who I am, I'm Abby. And this awesome lady was known to me as Granny. I knew it was going to start like this. Hang on. She was my granny for 20 years, 10 months, and 23 days. She wasn't only known to me as Granny, but she was Granny or Granny Kay to just about everyone who knew her. All of my cousins, most of my friends, and even a few of my ex-boyfriends called her that too. My friends in school knew her as my crazy redheaded granny who came to all my games. No matter the sport, she hooted and hollered and cheered. She never missed a grandparent's day in elementary school. She was always there. My cousins on the other side of my family even called her granny, and they might as well have been her grands because she would hug and kiss on them when they were little the same way she did with us. I struggled with what to say today when my mom asked me if I wanted to speak. I wasn't sure if I could do it, and it's yet to be determined still, but I just have so many stories and memories. I could stand up here and I know we could talk for hours about just how awesome Granny was and how much she already is and is going to continue to be missed. I won't talk for hours, but there's a few things that I do want to share. And first, these earrings I'm wearing, they're called puffball earrings. And I have them in like 8 different colors. And every time I wore them, Granny said she wanted a pair. And she said they were funky. Me and her always, we shared a love of funky jewelry. I remember going through her jewelry that hung on the back of the bathroom door. I'd never wear what I brought if we were going out. I wore some of hers because she just had better jewelry than I did. One of my favorite things I know we all enjoyed was when we would spend the night at Granny's house. We would lay in bed and eat pickles or cherries cold right out of the fridge. My older cousins watched Golden Girls with her. But when me and Chloe started getting old enough to spend the night, we watched Lifetime movies, and we had absolutely no business watching those Lifetime movies when we were that young, but it was okay, because it was Granny's house. When me and Chloe were younger during the summers, we would stay with Granny during the day while our parents were at work. We watched NCIS like it was going out of style. My mom did not like that we watched NCIS. She said we were too young, and she probably wasn't wrong. And Granny did what Mom wanted for like a week. We started watching it again, and I'm a rule follower, and I always have been. I'm just like my mom. But I was so scared we were going to get in trouble because Mom said no. But Granny promised it would be our secret. And besides, she said, Grannies outrate Mama sometimes. We all know Granny kept the best secrets. Granny would let me sip her margaritas, and I would gossip about boys. But, hey, listen, this is secrets, okay? I would gossip about boys and what friend made me mad that week, and she would always listen intently and ask questions, but she never told anybody. Another thing I'll always remember was no matter what we did that day, if we went out and got ice cream or went and ate dinner at La Cima, which was her favorite restaurant, spent the whole day shopping or just sat around and watched TV. When I would go to leave, Papa would always thank me for Granny sitting. I loved Granny sitting. Now it's going to be Papa sitting. I sure ain't going to miss those days. Yesterday was a big day for me. I graduated from college. I was really excited. Me and Granny had been talking about it for months. What we were going to do to celebrate and what I wanted for graduation. And I know she had the best seat in the house. And I just wish she'd been there to been able to give me a big hug. And you probably saw it on the screen. I brought a big picture of her with me. I wanted to surprise my mom because I wanted to take pictures with her because I knew she's there with me in spirit and my heart. One thing about Granny, there was never any doubt about how much she loved her grandkids and great-grandkids. Christmas stockings and birthday song phone calls every single year. I had a really hard time when I graduated high school and I didn't get a Christmas stocking anymore. And so I cried about it the first year I didn't get one. And Granny felt bad, so she gave me a little bag of candy and told me not to tell anybody because it wouldn't be fair to the other grandkids. But, I mean, you know, I like to think I'm the favorite, but we all were. I'm also going to miss getting those phone calls after those important life events. I started a new job last week, my first real big girl job, and I drove home Monday, and I was just boo-hooing the whole way because I wanted to get that phone call asking me how my first day went. I know she's watching over me, and she knew how it went. She didn't have to ask, but it was hard. I turned 21 in a month, and not getting my annual happy birthday song is going to be rough, but coincidentally enough, last year she called me on my 20th, and I missed that first phone call, and she left me a voicemail singing me happy birthday. So that's going to have to do for right now. Don't you worry, though. Me and Papa already got a date set. We're going to have a margarita at La Cima for Granny. We've already decided. Granny was the best granny I could ask for. She was kind, and I never once doubted how much she loved me and was proud of me. I'm going to continue to work to make her proud in everything I do. I miss her like crazy, and I'll see her again. I look forward to that. Until then, I have the best guardian angel looking down on me. The song that Sean's going to sing in a minute is called I Hope You Dance. Everyone knows how much Granny loved to dance. In fact, I'd be willing to bet she's probably up there teaching the angels how to do the twist and the jitterbug right now. It was Granny's favorite song on her Three Wooden Crosses CD. I love that CD. Car rides, anywhere. That's what we listened to. We didn't listen to the radio. The song talks about living each moment and taking nothing for granted. Well, Granny, I promise I'll never set out again. I promise I'll dance.
Well, clearly, Granny was corrupting my daughter at every chance. It reminds me of a story. Kay would, she'd always tell me, she'd say, Jess, you're a little hard on them girls. You're a little hard on them. And I remember her coming up to me several years ago and telling me, Jess, you know, I always told you was hard on them girls. But you've done a pretty good job of with them. And I said, Kay, did that hurt you to say? She goes, no, Jess, it didn't. Well, maybe just a little. Because, see, I'm starting to see what was going on at Granny's house. But that's okay. Because it's kind of like Las Vegas. What goes on at Granny's house stays at Granny's house, right? I see it. I get it. All y'all back there going, yep. Guys, I tell you what, as I got started, I'll be honest with you. I've preached a lot of funerals and my sister's funeral about a year ago. And this affected me a lot because the truth of the matter is I love my mother-in-law. And that sometimes can be kind of rare in this world. But I was sitting there and we were watching those pictures. One of the reasons I love my mother-in-law so much is because I loved watching her love other people. Because I loved how she loved my kids. I love how she loved all these grandkids. I loved how she loved all the great-grandkids. She loved everybody. Inside this church, Sean will sing here in a minute. Sean talked about what an encourager she was. She encouraged Sean. She loved people. Now, she didn't get along with you, or she didn't agree with you. She'd let you know. I ain't going to lie to you. I mean, and there's a time or two, me and her actually butted heads a time or two, believe it or not. over the years. But boy, I knew without a doubt how much my mother-in-law loved me. As I got a little sick, I've been a little sick, and my mother-in-law would call, and Brandy started going, you know, she goes, I'm going to tell Mom I'm her daughter, because the first thing Kay would say on the phone is, how's Jess? How's Jess? But that was just Kay. She was so caring and loving. I want to thank you all for being here today, for being here for the family. I want to thank you for the prayers. I want to thank you for the food, everything you guys have done for us. There's so many people. This old crazy COVID, so many people are staying away, and they'll watch this later or whatever else. I hope everybody knows how much as a family we love you and we thank you. Kay did love to dance. She did. A few days ago, I was thinking, last night was Friday, Thursday night. Thursday night, I was thinking, and I've known Kay just shy of 32 years. In just a few days, it'll be 32 years I would have known Kay. And I think about when we were younger, we went out dancing a lot. We'd go to clubs together with Dole and Kay. See, she'd crush you. Dadgummit, I'm starting to see a lot. I think it's Dole's fault. And so we'd go out dancing, and I loved it. And I got to thinking, I was actually mowing the church Thursday, and I was thinking, I used to dance with my mother-in-law. And I'm not talking about just dance. I mean, Dole probably already said, hey, pal. But we had such a good time. We just got there shaking booties. Because Kate shake that booty now. But she did that in everything in her life. That's the way she lived. It was all out. There wasn't no holding back. Dole talked about it. Dole talks about bright colored clothes she wore, jewelry. It's just her, man. She just lived life to the fullest. You know, I'm going to talk about it here. I think about Dole and Kay as they were younger, how it was travel all the time. They would travel a bunch, and it was go, 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 go. And then as we got to a gradual process, as we start to age, it was a little more getting closer to town, right? It was getting a little closer to Van Alstine. Favorite Mexican food restaurant used to be in Plano. Which one was it, Dole? What was it called? El Phoenix, there on the east side. Then we moved to McKinney on the west side. And then we moved to La Cima outside of Van because we're getting a little closer to home because we started to age a little bit. We still had a good time, though. Still had a good time. Because Mexican food means one thing. Mexican food means margaritas. Yeah. Mexican food means margarita. Chips and salsa, she couldn't eat it without a margarita, right? It's just the truth. I mean to tell you, I didn't have to go over that one. You know, they're just things that were coming through my mind. Kay is a sister. One thing about it, the rolling stick together. That's why them Bells people are over there. I could talk for a long time about that, but the rolling stick together. You mess with one of them brothers and sisters, you messed with them all. Kay loved her brothers and sisters so very, very, very much. I loved Kay talking about stories of when they were kids and all the scars and the picking on each other and her daddy slapping the boys around because he's picking on the girls and just all those crazy stories. But man, Kay loved her brothers and sisters. Kay was a meteorologist. She was a meteorologist, folks. I'm telling you. Kay, there could be a storm on the west side of Wichita Falls. And Kay Francis, she knew it was coming. She'd be calling me, Jess. I remember when they put a storm cellar in when they lived out on a hill out there with the trailer. When I first met Brandy, the storm cellar was sitting on top of the ground. And as I drove up one of the first times, I said, well, I ain't doing a lot of good. But Dole and them, they got that thing buried. And it floated the first time, didn't it, DR? Yep, and went back, reburied it, and that thing was there. I remember after that, I was walking. I'd come by to take Brandy out for dinner, and I'm walking up the steps, and I'm of that old trailer. You know, it was a long walkway, and there's Kay, and she is coming out of the house, and she's got a roll of like bedding, and she's walking, and she didn't say a word to me. She just walked right by me. I was like, "What's going on?" And then here comes Brandy. She's got some pillows. I said, "What's everything okay?" She goes, we're going to the cellar.
And I said, the dog come out. I said, DR, what's... He goes, boy, don't ask. We're going to the cellar. Come on with us. I said, no, if it's all right with you, I'm going to watch TV. And but that was Kay. She'd call me up. She'd say, Jess, there's a storm coming. Get them kids down here. Get them in the cellar, right? Kelsey's shaking her head because Kelsey's been in that cellar. And what it was is Kay's daddy was a little nervous about storms. Well, it got over on Kay, right? Y'all are all nodding your heads. You know this. And so I used to... Kay, I'd say, Kay, I'm not going to let you do this to my girls. They will not have this fear of storms. And, Jess, you need to get them down here. She'd get mad at me. She'd be on the phone at night, be dark. Jess, bring them down. No, Kay. But Kay did. She had those storms. Hey, y'all, I want you to think, and I don't mean to make. Doyle, when he moved her to Van Alstine, he had to put a, he was going to build her a safe room. So he had some metal put up on the walls. But Kay wasn't safe. She wasn't all the way secure with that because there was cans in there. She and I talked about it. There were cans in that closet. And so she got them bike helmets in case one of those cans flew around and it wouldn't hit them in the head. They had their little bike helmet. They're in there right now. I saw them the other night. But that's just Kay. That's just Kay taking care of everybody. She was a hugger and a kisser. We know that. Good night, that woman. She hugged on everybody. I was not a hugger. My family... I'm a hugger now, because the Apostle Paul talks about a holy kiss. Well, that really freaks people out, but I give people a holy hug now. But when I first met Kay, I'd be kind of uncomfortable. And even Tony, and because everybody hugged each other. And that, we were not big huggers in my family. Well, then I developed it, but that was Kay. And then there was Kay giving sugars, right? Everybody saw the pictures, and Abby talked about it. Brad talked about it. Brad's kids, they'd unload out of the car twice a year, and they would be in there trying to shove each other to see who was going to be the first one to get the mark of granny. And what the mark of granny was is, I don't know what kind of lipstick she wore, but when she going to kiss you right there, am I right, kids? Yep. And there's going to be a set of lips on your face. And then there was sometimes she could do it so fast, she'd reach up with her thumb and go, whoosh. And she would, if you never saw Zorro, the mark of Zorro was a Z. That was the mark of granny. She whipped it right across that old cheek. I even saw her a couple times with my girls, and I know everybody did it. She would go lick that thumb and then do it. But she did it so fast, them kids couldn't do nothing about it. If they tried to pull away, those hands would reach up, and they'd grab a hold of that head, pull them up there to them. There wasn't no getting away from it, was it, kids? Nope. You're going to get it. You're going to get the mark of granny. She treated every one of these kids like they were own. I'm going to tell you, that's why I love Kay, because she loved her family. She loved Greg, Brad, and Vance like they were her own sons. They were. She loved you guys so much. When she would talk about, we'd talk about stuff that were going on in y'all's lives, and she, just like you were her own. And Tony and Brandy and James, y'all know the reckless love that your mother had for y'all. It was something else. And that's what I loved that about Kay. I love watching her watch the family. I'm a people watcher. James and I were talking about it last night, some of the little mannerisms that Kay would have. I would watch Kay watch her family, and Kay would always put her hands up here on her face. Y'all, if you ever watched Kay, she had these little mannerisms about her. And I would sit there and just watch her. I'd watch her look at Kelsey's kids out there playing, her great-grandbabies. She wouldn't say a word. She'd just sit in a chair and watch them. She just loved them so much. She'd just sit there and observe them. At Christmas time, she'd work like crazy in that kitchen. Then I'd watch Kay. Like the stockings, she would just watch y'all. Her eyes would be bright just watching you guys open up all your stuff. She loved it. She loved watching her family. She was granny to everybody. Abby touched on it. There are kids from Stephenville, Texas, to for sure around Tom Bean, Texas, that they don't know who Kay Reynolds are, but they know who Granny Kay is. They know who Granny Kay is. That's just who she was. I called her Granny Kay half the time. Or Granny Grunt. That's Dole's name. Granny Grunt, right? And, I love seeing Dole and Kay, like I say, their relationship over the years. and how it grew and grew and grew. Dole would always, he had these little stuff for Kay, you know, nicknames and whatever else. And it was funny the other day, Dole don't always talk about it, said Kay was wormy. Dole's term, not mine, said Kay was wormy. She couldn't sit still. She had to be moving, right? Granny was always, she was doing something. She was painting something. There was nothing she wouldn't paint. If you sit still long enough, Granny slapped some paint on you. It's just the way she was. Gardening, that woman had, this morning when they were bringing in the flowers, I was thinking, oh my goodness. Because Kay loved flowers. She loved growing things. You know, she loved it. Elephant ears. That woman could grow elephant ears as big as a trash can lid, you know. She was always piddling with something, putting feathers on something, changing something. Kids, am I right? Yeah, Kelsey's over. Yep, yep. She put feathers on it, or she'd paint something. I've literally seen her paint a picture and then repaint it and then repaint it. Or mask, all that stuff. That I always like, man, that's kind of weird. But it's just Granny. Go big or go home. She loved to cook. Oh, man, she loved to cook. You know why? Because that was one of her love languages. She cooked for you. When I got sick, Kay would come in and she wanted to bring me food because she didn't know what else to do. I remember we had it back in July 4th maybe, and everybody brought stuff over. Kay makes this beans and ground meat. It's got like pork and beans and ranch style beans. It's just good. Boys, am I right? Come on, Chance. It's good. Dole, you like that too, right? Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's good. So I walk in, and I shouldn't have done it, but I went, Kay, where's your beans at? Oh, Jess, I made this, and it was some kind of healthy junk. And I was like, and I'm like, Kay, you know, and I was digging her because I was known to dig my mother-in-law a little bit, try to kind of get her going a little bit. You know what? That was on a Saturday. Guess what? On a Monday, guess who showed up at my house? Kay. With a big old bowl of beans for Jess. Yep, sorry, Dan. I'd had chemo that week. I was actually, I think, at chemo when she brought them. But that's just Kay. But of an evening, she loved to relax. She did. She loved her programs, right? She loved them. She'd want to watch, and that was, margaritas were for Mexican food. Wine was for relaxing. We'd have a glass of wine. She'd have a glass of wine, and she would go to watching her programs. And that introduced Granny to her newest nemesis, the remote control. And I thought it was just me that she was asking questions to. Come to find out, it's Dan and it's everybody. And Dole the other night, we're rewinding TV, and Dole's like, "Don't you do that? Don't get that voodoo going in this house." Because the recorder, you could go back and watch TV. Don't get that started. It'll mess it up. And Kay was kind of that way. One time I remember we were going somewhere, and she wanted to watch whatever program. At one point, once they lived in Tom Bean, it was Lost. She had to watch Lost. If she was going to miss an episode, it was bad. But she loved Lost. But anyway, whatever the program was, I said, Kay, just set it to record. You've got, you know, and I'm lined it out, you know, and she goes, Jess, can I just record all day long? I said, if you want to, I guess you could, but why would you want to? I'm recording all day long. I think I'll mess it up. And it was just her nemesis, that daggum thing. And I was sitting by the chair. There was a couple things about Kay. Dole and I were talking about the other night. She had a little basket beside her chair. And in that basket was crossword puzzles and word finds and a People magazine. I'd say something about a movie, and she'd go, "Hey, Jess, did you know old song Kevin Costner?" And you know, because she would keep up with People magazine, she knew all the ins and outs from People magazine. Because that was just Kay. It was one of her little things. Dole know it too. Dole would get all the Hollywood gossip because of a People magazine. I guess the best trait about Granny that I could think about was just spoiling Dole. Because, boy, she spoiled everybody. When I started dating Brandy, I remember Granny would always keep a little chocolate in the refrigerator. And she knew I liked eating that dark chocolate that she liked eating. And she'd always make sure that chocolate was in there. Because that's just the way she was. She wanted to take care of you. She wanted to take care of you. The words that I heard more in my life than anything is, let Granny get it. Let Granny get it. And I'd say, Granny, you're spoiling them kids. And I always say, me and Brandy trying to make them kids tough, and you over here baby them. Jess, you just let me take care of this. But she was that way with all the grandkids. Y'all all soft because of her. But no, Dole. Man, did she love you. Man, she loved you. I do. I've been around them for a long time. And to see their love, the maturation of their love, how it matured. I believe that it's kind of like growing. It's a growing love. It got to the point I told Kay, I said, Kay, you're spoiling Dole. I said, I said, you pick his clothes out for him. You set his clothes, his medicine. I said, you got to. She goes, Jess, I just won't take care of him. I just won't take care of him. That's the way Granny was. She won't take care of everybody. Abby was talking about, what did Pawpaw say? Granny setting? See, once the girls got older and Granny wasn't able to dote on them and she couldn't, it was Dole came into play. Dole came into play. Dole, she loved you so much. She loved you so, so very much. And I can tell you I'm a better husband today because of the love that I saw from you and Kay. I can tell you that. Kay was known by many, many names. She was known by Kay Francis, K.R., Sister, Mama, Mom, Granny, Granny Kay. But today, y'all, listen. She's known as a child of Almighty God. And she's worshiping the Father today in heaven. The passing of Kay is a great loss and a sad occasion. But those who know the Lord, as did Kay, it's a joyous occasion. For them, because they are now in the Lord's presence, our loss is her gain. When we got the phone call that we needed to go to the hospital, because things were not good, when we got there, Kay was gone. And I'm not going to lie to you, I miss, oh my goodness. I was brokenhearted for my wife, for Dole. But I got to be honest with you, I was just rejoicing for Kay. I was rejoicing for Kay. Because I knew there was a great reunion it had just happened. Brandy and I talked about it on the way home that morning. It was 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning. And we were talking about the reunion that Kay was having in heaven. And oh, I was so excited for her because I love her. And I was excited for what she was being able to go through. But I was sad for what we were going to have to go through. In the midst of sorrow, in the midst of grief, we need to remember, God has conquered it through His Son, Jesus Christ. Amen? Come on now, amen? Death has been conquered through Jesus. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whatever lives, and whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I want you to encourage you as we gather together this afternoon to remember that God is our refuge and our strength in difficult times. We are ever embraced in the arms of an everlasting Lord. I want to pray right here. Before we even get started, I pray that you guys, first of all, y'all be praying for our family. Because if this is a time right now of ever, it's just to embrace each other in prayer. Let's pray before we get. And Kay should have known better. She had a son-in-law that was a preacher and a son that was a preacher. So we're going to have to do a little preaching through this thing. That's okay, though. That's what Kay wanted. I'm telling y'all. Now listen, let's pray. Let's go to the Lord and pray. Father God, thank you Thank you today, but I pray that you are our refuge. Father, you are our strength. Father, you help us in times of trouble. You help us in times of grief. And today's one of those days, Lord. We need your help. We need your strength, Father. You are our dwelling place. We find refuge in you. So we place our trust in you today, Lord. Lift us from the shadows of this old dark world and help us to see the light of eternity that can be found only in you. Help us to find grace and mercy. Help us to find us in this time, Lord. This time, Lord, just shelter this family. Love them. Let your grace and mercy fall over them. Father God, thank you for all you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Last night I was praying about this service, about what I wanted to do a good job for Kay. I really did. That's one reason. I just want to do this for Kay. Something to say to bring comfort to the family for the loss of such a great woman. But in fact, there's nothing I can do or say that will take the pain away, that will fill the gap that's missing in her heart. The only thing that can do that is I believe if we turn to the Word of God, and I pray that today you'll find some comfort in these words. Again, every person, please be lifting each other up, family. Be lifting each other up in prayer. I think, you know what Granny would want most of all? She would want this to bring us that much closer. I really do. She would tell you, just let this bring you that much closer to loving each other. Love each other harder, more. Love more, carry less around with you, and just love each other. But in scriptures, there's comfort there. As we go through the healing process, I was thinking about it. I mean, even in my own self, I thought about it. Dole and I have talked about it. It's the mourning process, to mourn. Well, it's great for us to remember the awesome memories that we have, okay? We cannot skip over the mourning process. It is a part of life, and it is meant to draw us closer to the Lord in so many ways, many which are unexplainable. It's part of the great mystery. We mourn, but yet it brings us closer to the Lord. That's what Granny would want. That's what Granny would want. John chapter 11, verses 33 through 35. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved, and his spirit was troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." And Jesus wept. Jesus knows what this feels like. Jesus wept. It's the shortest verse in the Bible. Everybody likes that Bible trivia, right? But listen to the words. Jesus wept. He knows what it is. And Jesus knew where Lazarus was. Jesus knew everything that was going on, but he saw the grief and the pain that his friends, his loved ones were going through, and it broke his heart. He understands what you're going through today. He knows what you're going through. Matthew chapter 5, verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. In the midst of sadness and mourning, we can rejoice because of the hope that is found in our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life," in John chapter 11, 25 through 26. He said, "I am the resurrection and life. He who believes in me will live, even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." Do you believe this, church? Amen? Granny K's, this is not Granny K. Granny K is in heaven today. She's rejoicing in heaven today. Jesus was talking to Martha here about the death of Lazarus. She is having a hard time understanding what Jesus is getting ready to do, which would be raise Lazarus from the dead. But Jesus gives us a glimpse of the future in this passage. He says, "He who believes in me will never he who believes in me will live, even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." At this point, Jesus turns the conversation to eternity. And I want y'all to think, I want to read one more passage from this. This is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. But we did not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you, the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and a voice of the archangel, and then the trumpet of God, and the dead will be raised in Christ first. Then we who are alive will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we always be with our Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Second coming of the Lord. That all who believe in Christ will have eternal life in heaven. And Brad touched on it. These are not just stories. These are not just stories. This is the truth. This is the truth that I'm going to promise you. K. Reynolds put everything in. That one day, we will see all of our loved ones again. We will see all of our brothers and sisters in Christ, but we will see Kate again. Back to chapter 11 in John. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. And he asked her that question, do you believe this? It's a question that every one of us has to answer at one point in our life. Do you believe this? Martha's response was an emphatic, yes, Lord. I believe Kay answered that question in her lifetime. In fact, I know it. And said, yes, Lord, I believe. I got to have many discussions with Kay about her faith. It was, as relationships change, conversations change. The last few years, her and Dole and I, we talked about funerals. We talked about death. We talked about heaven. And it was so crazy as we would sit there and Kay would say, you know, Jess, Kay feared the process of dying. But she didn't fear dying. She knew heaven awaited her. She knew it. I had a conversation about, halfway up this aisle with her 2 months ago. And we talked about everything from Dole to eternity. And it was funny. Kay would sit there and she goes, Jess, I don't know why. We'd have these conversations about death and dying. She'd go, you think it would, but it makes me feel better every time we talk about it. I said, Kay, it should. I loved talking about Jesus with my mother-in-law because she'd get so excited. I got to look in her Bible. And there was just so many things. And she, you know, a lot of times she would underline where she stopped reading. Because Dole tell you, she read that Bible every day. Amen. Didn't she, Dole? Every day she'd sit there and read that Bible. Well, that's Kay. Kay came forward not too long ago for a kind of an altar call we had. And Kay wanted to reaffirm something to Jeremy. It was literally the week before she got sick. She said, Jeremy, I just want to do more for the Lord. I want to do more. Isn't that something? I love hearing a 77-year-old woman tell me she wants to do more for the Lord. But that's my mother-in-law. Because just like her relationship with Dole was deepening, so was her relationship with the Lord. And it was awesome to see. I want to read from the 23rd Psalm right quick. These are words that she and I talked about. Jeremy, I think it was me that had it in a sermon, the 23rd Psalm. And Kay told me how much she found a lot of comfort in it. And if you look in Kay's Bible, the most writing and underlining she did or highlighting was in the Psalms. She loved the Psalms. She found reassurance in them. And knowing Kay, she was singing to them, right? Because that's just a joyful thing. But she loved the 23rd Psalm. I think it was me preaching. Pretty sure. But I want to read that to you right quick. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou dost prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemy. Thou hast anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love, loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This psalm assures us that God is there for us to guide us, to lead us through times of trouble and hardship. Jesus said, Come unto me, all you who are labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I encourage you, family, to do that. Kay would encourage you to do that. To not waste this opportunity to grow closer to the Lord. That woman loved to glorify the Lord. She did. I love talking to Kay about it. I want to pray right quick, and then Sean's going to come up and sing a little song. And Sean, I hope I'm going to say this for Sean. Sean had talked about the encouragement that Kay gave her. Kay did. This song, you're going to, if there's a song that shows Kay Reynolds, this is it. Y'all grab a hold of you listen, because she'd want you to. She'd want you to grab hold of the words of this and dance. Dance. Do everything you can for those around you. Love deeper than you've ever loved before. Y'all go with me in prayer right quick. Father God, I give you thanks for Kay. I give you thanks for this family. I love them. I love them so much, Lord. We loved Kay, Lord, so, so very much. But I know in my heart you love Kay that much more. I can't even fathom the love that you had for Kay. Father God, today I ask for your rest and your comfort and your mercy upon those I love so much. Please bring it, Lord. Father God, thank you for Kay. Thanking you for the way Kay changed me as a man. The way that she taught me to love more. Lord, I thank you for all you do for us, but most of all, I thank you for Jesus, and it's his name I pray. Amen.
Forbid love ever leave you empty-handed. And I hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. And whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. And promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice, taking chances, but they're worth taking. Loving might be a mistake, but it's worth making. So don't let some helping heart leave you bitter. When you come close to selling out, reconsider. Give the heavens above more than just I hope you dance. fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance.
This says it. Y'all, Kay, I know that song where it talks about go rest high on that mountaintop. Kay and I had we had a lot of stuff in common. One of them was we love of mountains. Dole knows that. And if there's mountains in heaven, which I believe there is, I believe there's mountains that we can't even comprehend what they look like. I believe that Kay is there because I know how much Kay loved to hear those streams running through there, waterfalls. I believe she's on one of those mountains somewhere today. This is not the end. Listen to me. It's not. This is just, when Kay left us that Saturday morning, it wasn't a goodbye. It was a, I'll see you later. Because I'm going to tell you, each and every one of us, we're going to have that. We're going to have that reunion. We have that. It, through Jesus, we can have that reunion. And I'm going to tell you, I know one of the people who will be there to welcome me, and that's Granny Kay. I want to read this poem. I don't know the author. I found it, and I want to read it. Little, and then we're going to close, guys. We're done. Little do we know that morning that God would call your name. In life, you loved us dearly. In death, we do the same. It broke our hearts to lose you. You did not go alone, for part of us went with you that day that God called you home. You left us peaceful memories. Your love is still our guide. And though we cannot see you, you are always on our side. Our family chain is broken, and now nothing seems the same. But as God calls us one by one, that chain will link again. And guys, it will. I want let's pray, and then we're gonna be done, guys. Father, I do. I pray. First, Lord, I thank you for Kay Reynolds. I thank you for the 32 years I got to know Kay. I thank you for the children that you gave her. I thank you for the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren. I thank you for this family, what they mean to me, how they've just, I can't even put it into words how much I love them. But Lord, today I just pray your comfort. I always said it, Lord, that you gave me another mom and daddy in Dole and Kay. And I truly believe that. Today, though, Dole is left, and I pray you comfort him, Lord. I pray you fill his heart with love, that he knows how many people care about him. He knows how we love him. He knows that we're behind him and that we need him. Father God, thank you for all you do for us. Thank you for Kay. Thank you for the memories, Lord. Help us to dance through this life, bringing glory and honor to you, loving more, caring less with us, and just giving glory to you. Let us never forget the times we had with Kay. Lord, just keep them fresh in our memories, Lord. But just heal us as we go through this time. Lord, today won't be the end. There's going to be so many times, I know even in myself, that I'm going to be driving down the road and hear a song and just break down and cry like a baby because I miss Kay. But Lord, I pray that you will come in and comfort us in those times and we'll draw closer to you. Most importantly, we'll draw closer to you because I know that's what Kay would want. Father God, thank you for all you do for us. Thank you for Kay. Thank you for this family. Thank you for all those who have lifted us up. I pray your blessings upon them. Lord God, but most of all, I thank you for Jesus. Thank you for Jesus because through Jesus, we can all meet again. I'm going to see Kay again. So Lord God, just thank you. Lord, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.